these S-rank reviews that I do, and sometimes B-ranks and sometimes A-ranks, although I haven't done those for quite some time, these reviews that I do, they're not really reviews, they're more overviews. It's not just my two cents on the matter, it's my first impressions, like my first experience using a unit as opposed to always facing off against it or always wondering what's it like. Well, I've kind of been on the receiving end of that where I looked in the store and I was like, I want to get this, but I don't know what it's like. I don't know, you know, is it going to do good damage? Does it have good mobility? Does it, you know, there's a bunch of questions I go through. And believe it or not, I would have nothing to work with if OG Planet hadn't stopped giving us those free sampler S-ranks. You know, at the beginning of every month, they would give us whatever the S-rank is for that month that they're going to be releasing. They would give us a free sampler. If you played this many days, you'd get a free sampler of the upcoming S-rank, and you would be able to plot ahead. Like, well, okay, is this worth it or is it not? If they hadn't stopped doing that, I would have no ammunition to work with for making these reviews. But because they stopped doing that, lo and behold, I could do that. That being said, as I've been doing these, the question has come up, should I review the Freedom, Justice, and Providence Gundams, also known as the Poverty Tier S-Ranks? I don't count Destiny as Poverty Tier, because you actually have to do a bit of work in order to get that one, so, you know, whatever. But everybody can get to them. It's actually really easy. Well, I mean, yeah, they're called Poverty Tier for a reason, and let's see, complete reward unit, quest unit, no one knows. All you have to do is single mission ground on easy, and you get that. And then you do single mission ground in space on easy, and then you get the Freedom Gundam. So that's by far the easiest one to get. That you get that one immediately. Where's the next one? S-rank assignment 2, clear the initial combat tutorial. Initial combat tutorial is literally just, what is it? It's just showing off how to use the different weapons. It's teaching you how to use a long-range sniper rifle. It teaches you how to use homing weapons. It teaches you how to use a machine gun. It teaches you how to use grenades, on and on down the line. That's all that does. And you can actually stack it. And once you do that, I mean, once you learn how to use all the weapons, it gives you Providence Gundam. Okay, whatever. You see quite a few of these. Justice Gundam's a little harder to do. Initial combat tutorial, again, for whatever reason, Softmax doesn't let you stack these quests. You can't have them both running at the same time for whatever reason. It only lets you do one at a time. So it's frustrating you have to do it twice, but, you know, whatever. That's not the problem. The problem is having to get to the advanced combat tutorial where you have to play against type. You use a long-range sniper rifle to take down a melee unit. You use a melee unit to take down units that are hiding and waiting to attack you as you come around the corner, and you have to decide what your priorities are. There's also, you know, poking around a corner with a beam machine gun and doing all kinds of things like that. So it gets to be a pain in the ass real quickly. Everybody kind of struggled with this one. But eventually you get the Justice Gundam. In my opinion, definitely worth it. Underrated, but worth it. So the question for me has been, do I review the Freedom, Justice, and Providence Gundams? Because they are, after all, known as the Poverty Tier S-Ranks. Destiny Gundam, not so much. But, and I'm still debating that. So I will only go so far as to say, if you're satisfied with the Freedom Gundam, in my opinion, the Strike Freedom Gundam is exactly the same thing, but with improvements, but with add-ons. So if you like the Freedom Gundam, you can easily transition into the Strike Freedom Gundam, and not just because it adds the word Strike to the front of Freedom Gundam. So first up we have what I affectionately call long range mode. Nothing but long range weapons. That kind of stuff. Jumping. Don't stand on top of each other. God damn, what are you... I need you next to each other. Thank you. Oh, jeez. I wish these guys just stand in the middle and that's it. No, don't fucking stand up. I don't believe this. Thank you. Now fucking hold still. Obviously penetrates. Is not a knockdown cannon. It's just a long-range beam cannon that does a thing. Weapon 2 is a knockdown. Now, in case you haven't noticed, the very first skill, the first skill slot is a reload up. Think about that for a moment. A reload up on an SS rank, which means that becomes that. I don't think that this can knock down anti-flinch units. I don't think it can. It doesn't recharge that. It's more like a 3-second reload charge. But this, you definitely get more shots out of it. 2, 3, 4 shots with patience. Previously it was just 3. Now you get a 4th shot. And it recharges just fast enough. You really don't have to worry about recharge. Weapon 3, the Super Dragoons. And by the time those disappear, you only have to wait 2 or 3 seconds. Oh, there they are right there. Now, there is a small problem with the Strike Freedom Gundam, particularly in this... Let me get rid of this. Ba-boom. Now, there is a bit of an issue with the Super Dragoons, or at least the arrangement of the weapons on the Strike Freedom Gundam. Weapon 2 is the knockdown, rather than the typical Weapon 3. Weapon 3, this is unusual to have the knockdown and funnels on the same, either in the same mode or on the same unit. So watch what happens. If you're like me and you have difficulty throwing remote weapons, here's what can happen to you. You're spamming and boom. You just knocked them down, which means they have to take the time to stand up, which means those remote weapons missed once, maybe twice, those shots. So it does get to be a bit frustrating. You know, you're trying to spam those remote weapons, and then you spam too much, and bam, you knock them over, and you lose an opportunity for some damage. That's not to say that it's not still good to have that long-range knockdown and remote weapons. It's just really awkward when the program switches, or the game switches automatically for you. That becomes a bit of an issue. Again, it's a beam cannon because he puts away all those weapons for some reason. And when you transform into the kind of normal mode, then lo and behold, your dragoons disappear. Oh yeah, by the way, in order to transform, you must have all 6 of your dragoons. Or, I'm sorry, your super dragoons. Your motes. You must have all of them in order to transform. Not quite sure why, considering the fact that it never uses any of them. And if anything, you notice those wings, the dragoons aren't there anyway. So why it is you have to transform, or you have to have all 6 in order to do that, I don't understand it. But you do. 5-hit knockdown, by the way. Five hits on a scissors. No, I'm sorry, is this a paper? I think this is a paper. So it's 5 hits on a paper. Beam rifles. A 6, 9, 10, 11, 12. And the reload is fast enough, you basically never run out of ammunition. And again, it's, let's see, 1, 2, 5, and 6 to kill your average C-ranks. So not only is it a powerful, because it's a double-shot beam rifle, but it reloads near instantly. 3 shots, hold it down, 4 with patience. But again, You're basically going to be using Weapon 2 the entire time to spell Weapon 3. Weapon 3 is kind of a special occasion, whatever. And really, that's how it was in, was it the normal Freedom Gundam? This, I'll tell you right now, the arrangement of weapons on here and how they function, more or less, and not including the reload, behave more or less identical to how the... This is the Freedom Gundam mode right here. They behave exactly the same. It's when you get to this mode that things kind of switch up a bit. Now for the special. So you see the 5 melee hits that I did are more or less identical to what the special attack, the melee special attack can do. And I believe there is splash on this. No! No splash on these. Wait, or did I? You're right there. Let me see. Yeah, there's no splash on those rail cannons. Which is strange, but, you know, whatever. Made a promise a long time ago to this guy that I would eventually get him into one of my video reviews. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the longest standing members in Clan Okami, the one, the only, Maxzilla 96, Koolkid101495, say hello to the world.
Hey guys, what's going on?
Koolkid, I actually didn't bring you here to be a punching bag. I actually brought you here to beat me up a little bit. So if you'd be so kind as to drop me below 50%.
Sure thing.
Not even 50%. What kind of rock are you? Better? No, boost down. What am I going to do? I've got no booster bar. Wait, here it is. Okay. Wait. No. Koolkid, I still got a problem. I think you glitched my game because I've got no booster bar whatsoever, and I believe I just now beat the SR Sinanju as the longest boosting unit in the game. Probably because my second skill is actually what is known as the N-Jammer Canceller, which in SDGO translates as infinite boost. You boost forever. As long as you hold down, you can even boost sideways. Forever. Forever, never, never. The only stipulation is when you jump, you use a little boost. You jump again, use a little bit boost. Of course, you can only double jump in this game, which is really dumb. But, yeah. There it is. Infinite boosting. And if I remember correctly, even though I'm not totally not reviewing it right now, the Infinite Justice also has an infinite boosting, showcased by that cute little pink hue that he has all over him right there.
Sadly enough, my boost bar isn't even showing up, thanks to NJC.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I love it. Yeah, you don't see the... You have unlimited horizontal boosting. Beyond that, yeah, now, Koolkid, we've got a little over a minute here. If you could please kill me so I can show off what the regular boost duration looks like. Thank you, sir.
You're very welcome.
I shouldn't have called him sir. Now, of course, I would like to show off the regular boost duration. And keeping in mind, folks, this is a scissors we're talking about here. Is that right? Yeah, this is a scissors. Although it does have an awful lot of long range for a scissors, so, yeah. But it has the boost duration with scissors. So, yes.
Let's not forget, it's also got the 4-swing like a scissors.
No, actually, I think it's got a 5-swing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Oh.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, it's a 5-swing.
Hmm. One of my favorite units in this game, and I've completely forgotten that.
Yeah. Yeah. Seriously, you're talking to a professional Seed fanboy here. He's definitely one of the biggest Seed fanboys I've known. And definitely Infinite Justice. Yeah, Infinite Justice is one of Koolkid's favorite units to use in the game, bar none. Shut up. Okay, so the range of weapons that it offers up, pretty solid. The one big thing that I don't like, it's the thing that I don't like about Strike Freedom Gundam, I almost said Strike Freedom Meteor, which is totally wrong, is that you start with the Super Dragoons, and yes, Dragoon is an acronym, that's not a misspelling, it actually is large letter like that. The Super Dragoons, the remotes, as soon as you fire them all off, by the way, did you notice that you're actually firing off 8 Super Dragoons rather than just the standard 6? It's not a change in damage, it's just you've got... Oh, wait, is that right? 8? 6?
It's 8.
Yeah, it's 8. Okay, yeah. Who asked you? But anyways, as soon as you fire these off, it automatically switches weapons, which I'm not a fan of. Like, it doesn't matter what this weapon is. I still wish that this had stayed red. Not, and I say this of any unit that has remote weapons on it, so I'm just going to reiterate here. I don't like it when it switches. I've seen some units where they switch to weapon 1, which was a melee. And so, as you're trying to spam these things, which some people do, it doesn't matter if you count them out or not. The point is, you're trying to click the mouse really hard, and then you know, it finally goes off, because you're like, come on, fire already! fire everything! You know, you want it to do that, and it's not, and then all of a sudden it fires off the last one, and then bam! It switches to a weapon you don't like, that you didn't want to use, that's completely inappropriate. Cubilet Papillon. Cubilet Papillon, for example, has remote weapons as well, and it switches from weapon 3 to weapon 1, and you do a melee dash all of a sudden, which is really, really unfortunate. So Strike Freedom, unfortunately, is one of those units where it has a remote, once you use them all up, and if you're still clicking, it'll automatically switch you over to the second weapon. In this case, it switches you over to a knockdown. Beyond that, you've got some... It's not a perfect spammer. Like, you can continuously use it like you can on the myriad versions of White Unicorn Gundams. The A rank is definitely a long-range spammer. The Beam Gatling has some good range on it. The Unicorn Awakened version definitely has some good long-range spam. This one does not spam, although it has a fast enough reload, you don't have to think about it. So it's not a spammer, but you can wait, you know, 1 or 2 or even 3 seconds, and lo and behold, you've got a free shot up there. So that's not an issue. And as I mentioned previously, the alternate mode, where you've got the... Crap, what's the glowing wing thing called again? Cool kid, I can't remember.
Wings of the Sky. It's also known as the Vulture Lumiere.
Vulture Lumiere, thank you. That's Vulture or Vulture? Vulture.
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 I botched it. It's Vulture.
Yeah, it's Vulture. So the Vulture Lumiere, which is apparently a plasma solar flare-induced shield solar sail thing, which has absolutely no relevance whatsoever to this unit or this mobile suit in the show. Just saying, when you're in this mode, it more or less behaves just like the regular S-Rank Freedom Gundam. So, and this is now the third time or so that I've mentioned it, if you like the regular Freedom Gundam, you're literally getting exactly the same thing here. The same amount of shots, the same amount of damage here, and the same reload, blah, blah, blah. The only difference is you actually have a reload up. So you get... those beam rifles basically go forever. They really do. So even if you run out of ammo, you're recharging so quickly that you more or less have infinite ammo on this. Alt mode, weapon 1. 5-hit melee on a scissors, which is unusual, not unheard of, not necessarily a bad thing. Kira Yamato dominates all. Shut your face. And then you've got the rail cannons, which, despite having a reload up, still have only 3 shots before you have to wait for the reload. So despite having a reload up and everything else having a good reload, much like a normal mode weapon 1, alternate mode weapon 3, you actually do have to worry about a reload rate. But I'm not going to worry about a reload rate. This is one of those occasions where I don't think about, like, if this weapon, which I'm not very good at, doesn't have a great reload rate, I don't care. This weapon goes out to long range, I don't really care. Because it reloads fast enough, it's like, oh, okay, I have to wait a little bit. But I'm not in panic mode. Oh my god, recharge, oh my god, recharge, oh my god, recharge. It's not that case at all. So you're very much spamming at long range. For the sake of this discussion, I'm not going to bring up the Neutron Jammer Canceller as an attribute. That, to me, it very much is. I mean, hello, it's right there. And by the way, it's not just booster capacity, but it's also search distance, which means absolutely nothing to me. And you also get radar, which, yes, can indeed be useful. Because it means you can plan the strategies of where you're going to be showing up. So Neutron Jammer Canceller EX is definitely a thing. But when talking about how you want to set this up and how these things are going to be treated, I'm just going to ignore the Neutron Jammer Canceller, and Koolkid, I request that you do too. So, being the Strike Freedom enthusiast that you are, Koolkid, if you would lead the discussion on... first of all, tell me, how is your Strike Freedom set up? Do you have an arrangement?
I actually do, and as I see it now, I think yours is level 11, while mine's sitting at level 12, because I love this unit with a passion.
If he could EX it, he would, ladies and gentlemen, I'll attest to that.
I've actually had it set up even before G-Generation, before we have the new type setup we have now. I actually had it as a mobility type. I actually do still have mine as a mobility type. And everything that I have on it, it's the level 12 enhanced jump booster. No additional booster consumption when dash jump. I also have the level 10 increase attack. I also have, and the rest of these are just level 10, it's the level 10 long range weapon speed increase and the medium range speed increase. So,
And what's your reason for doing it that way? Give me your thoughts process here.
Well, as far as I saw it when I first got the Strike Freedom, it's the speed on its weapons, how long it took to fire them, it really didn't do all that much for me. And without thinking about it, you're just sitting there kiting all over the place, and suddenly you realize you're out of boost. What are you going to do? Well, when you jump up in the sky, thanks to the enhanced jump booster, it's pretty much, okay, you're boosting diagonally, or you're boosting upwards. While you're boosting around, it's not going to take any of that away. And I felt like everything else could have done more damage. Otherwise, I would have gone with a complete attack build. But I felt like it needed the dash booster, or the jump booster, a lot.
So you feel that this would be treated as some kind of a kiting unit?
Right. Just stay up in the air, just fire, fire, fire. Fire, fire, fire! And stay up there forever, try not to get hit. Hmm. And as long as you stay up there and not getting hit, you're all well and good.
Does 3 points of attack increase, does that really make that much difference? I mean, is it like, when's the last time you ran it without that? And, I mean, did you really notice the difference?
As far as I can remember, when I first built the unit, I felt like it was a little lacking. It's subtle, but it does hit harder.
Okay. So why then didn't you, because, except for this additional boost jump, everything you see here is something you can achieve in the defense type and the attack type. Why didn't you just go with the attack type instead? I mean, why not just, you know, have it hit as hard as it possibly can? You've got pretty much a full spam weapon in the melee mode, the alternate mode, weapon 2 with the dual beam rifles. You've got unlimited ammo there, and then you've got a fairly good reload on that long-range beam cannon in the standard mode. So you feel it just, like, despite the spam, you felt that it just wasn't enough? You thought that, I don't know, the death by a thousand cuts mentality wouldn't cut it?
When it first came to, I thought the death by a thousand cuts, like, I felt like the weapons were slow, and if you were to actually play me in SDGO, I go in, I hit you as hard as I can, I back off or go to a next target. That's pretty much my playstyle. But when it comes to something like the Strike Freedom, it feels like it doesn't do as much as I want it to. And the way I see it, if it wasn't just for the jump booster, I would go complete attack.
If you were to go with an attack type, which sounds interesting, would you still go with the same... Oops. Reset custom slots. Okay. Would you still go with the same attack with this arrangement? If it wasn't for that one booster thing. And even if it wasn't, would you say... maybe this one? Because it seems to me like you're talking about something like agility, the response of the unit, as opposed to attack rate and cooldown. I mean, do you really think that the weapons don't respond good enough or something?
Well, if I was going for an attack build with this, with this unit, I would definitely keep the increased mobility, or not the increased mobility, but the medium range speed increase and the long range speed increase. I would have gone with the omnidirectional crit, and I would have actually gone with the enhanced range spec. Because if I see a lot of people together, I feel like I've got to go all out, fire, 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 die. I want to take you out as fast as I can.
But wait a minute. You would use the enhanced range special attack?
Yeah, because of the special attack in mode one. Like, I've actually tested it out before. You can actually get not a minimum of 5, but I think it's as many as you can. So I'm guessing about as many as how much does a normal deathmatch room or a normal room hold?
6 per side, I think. Well, you tell me. I don't play deathmatch. I hate deathmatch. So you should be able to tell me. It shouldn't really matter, because as I understand it, the point of the enhanced range spec. I hope you're watching the camera right now. The purpose of the enhanced range spec special attack is to, you don't get a decreased percentage of damage on each target. So in other words, I think you're still restricted by a maximum of 5 targets per ranged special. You're still limited by that, and it actually shows it on the icon right here. But this just means that each unit will get the full amount of damage that it would if you had hit only just one target. So you're not penalized for that. That's what this special attack, or that's what this particular trait gives you. So I don't know if you're looking for that. I mean, it certainly would. I mean, it would be an advantage, but that assumes that you're aiming for multiple targets in one hit. Otherwise, this is specifically designed for multiple targets. So this might be good on, like, say, a Zabanya, which is actually a really good spammer in a lot of different ways. That would be good for something like that. But would you not then instead want the all-around unit attack increase instead? So in other words, we would, let's see, how would we do it? We did this, come on, and this, come on, and this, and then the critical damage here.
Well, I'm also one of those players who kind of relies on their spec a lot, so that's why, that's why I actually chose the, enhanced range special attack.
Okay. But your preference, at this point, your preference is on the mobility tree and that level 12 enhanced jump booster.
That way I can stay in the air as long as I can, and I can hit you death by 1,000 cuts.
Okay. All right.
If not harder.
I just got interrupted. I had to spend a few minutes away. So, okay. So Koolkid's recommending a mobility type just to be able to get that, the level 12 boost, which, you know, fair enough. Of course, mine's been sitting here unmodified for quite some time, and I can't remember what mine was like before, G Generation either, or G Revolution. Generation Revolution. I don't know why they changed it. But anyways, what would I do with mine? Well, it's definitely the long-range thing. It's weird. It's actually really... this behaves like a long-range combat unit in that it can actually do a lot at long range. The cannons have good range on them. You can spam this pretty well. In kind of a weird way, with the exception of the Super Dragoons, this... I've often thought of the Strike Freedom Gundam as a scissors version of the Wing Zero Custom EW. Did I just say EW? Yes, I did. God damn it, everybody shouldn't have said that. Of the Wing Zero Custom. Because it's got one mode where you're spamming long range. And then for the close range thing, oh, look, you've got beam rifles that do really well, and then you've got some sort of a physical attack so you can cut through beam shields and eye fields and things like that. So I tend to think of this as a Wing Zero Custom, or at least the scissors equivalent of a Wing Zero Custom. What would I use for a rock equivalent? Ugh, I have no idea. But that's how I tend to think of this thing, where, and you know, like Koolkid's attitude when he plays, he's much more aggressive than I am. I play more of the support role, so me, I'd be leaning primarily on this long-range mode for the support, and then if I have to, lo and behold, I've got some really good stuff in the alternate mode. That being said, I don't find anything particularly wrong with this. Reload rates are good, and not just because the reload up is, it's really strange to have a reload up on an SS rank. Like, you don't think that'd be an issue, but okay, I think I already went over that. But I don't see any reason to enhance and reload up, and I was also surprised, Koolkid, you were using attack increase, or attack speed and cooldown speed changes, which I thought was an interesting way to go. And the reason I bring that up is because that knockdown cannon, come on, go away, that knockdown cannon in the normal mode, and by the way, the only way you can tell the difference between which mode you're in is either have the Super Dragoons in place or you don't. That's the only difference. This cannon has that snapshot ability just like it does on the regular F-91. It just fires. You know, it pulls the cannons out, and it fires, and it's done within a second. It fires very, very quickly. So I don't worry about the attack speed on there. If you're at long range, you don't have to worry about acting quickly. Oh, shit, I'm not going to make that shot in time. So I'm not worried about that there. When it comes to the medium range weapons, I think the spam kind of makes up for the attack speed and the cooldown, so I'm not really worried there. Because this has dumbfire, but I don't use dumbfire primarily, and this is one of the exceptions that I make for a dumbfire weapon. The only thing I'd really worry about is the reload rate on this, but again, this has such good spam, I'm not worried about reload rate here. So changing attack speed and cooldown, just from my perspective, it's not something that I would do. I don't really feel a need. I don't think it's lacking in response. As an SS rank, it damn well better not have any response issues. Just saying.
Well, I'm sorry, dude. I actually thought about that, and with what you're saying, if you do have that, attack speed and cooldown on it, even though you have that reload up, you're sitting there and you're constantly bam, 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 dual shot. I'm pretty sure you covered that. But yeah, it's just 1-2, 1-2, 1-2.
You're talking with the dual beam rifles, right?
Yeah. That dual the way I play it, it's fired twice with the dual beam rifles, switch to the rail cannons, and then switch back, just sit there 1-2 2-3, 2-3, 2-3, 2-3, 2-3. And then occasionally just switch back to the elder mode and go from there.
That's reasonable. Yeah, I mean, if this is the primary spamming weapon, then you might as well use it that way and just lean on it. And I agree, if you could fire this thing twice, that'll be just enough time for a single shot of this to recharge. If you drop this down a little way, if you drop the ammo to zero on this, fire this twice, by the time you do, weapon three will have a single shot back. So I I've witnessed something similar as well. Like I said, you're a bit more aggressive in how you operate compared to me. Like I said, I lay back a little more, take my time to line up my shots and make certain that I'm providing support. If it gets to a close range fight, then yeah, absolutely, it'll be good to have. But that's kind of my point, is the attack speed, cooldown, and even agility on this unit is high enough that I don't really think about it. I don't have to think about it. It doesn't really cross my mind. So for your build, you want to make it respond as fast as you possibly can. For my build, I don't really see any need to change what's already there. If anything, I was going to say, what I was thinking to do is maybe doing an attack build. The boost duration, obviously you don't have to worry about that. Although since it's a scissors, it already has a good boost duration on it. I might consider putting the dash on there to make it extend out to rock or something closer to a rock styled boost duration. So And of course, because I'm more about survivability than I am about shooting, than agility and dodging, I'll probably do the 500 HP on there. Which, by the way, also means that my neutron jammer canceller activates sooner and it stays active for a longer amount of time. So I might do that, and then do an attack up, just a general attack up in the attack tree specifically. Not because it needs it, but just because, why not? I can do it. Your recommendation of using the hand screen special attack, that's kind of an interesting way of going about that. I don't know that I would do it, but that certainly is an interesting way to do it, especially with the ranged special attack. Now, I'm not as good a shot as you are, Koolkid, and, you know, I'll fess to that, fair enough. So this might actually be, you know, give me a leg up if I can actually get my shots to connect properly.
With that preference in mind, I would say, I would suggest...
Me, Koolkid? You gonna tell me what to do? You gonna push me around a bit? You wondering that?
I would suggest putting the omnidirectional crit on it for your preference, just so you can say I'm adding an extra few cuts just to that.
If this was level 12, and actually, what would it take to get this level 12? What would it take? Quite a bit. Well, actually, I have quite a bit. Imagine that. I could. Like I said, it's not a high priority for me. And the more I think about it, I almost think that this is a balance type. It behaves for me. It's good reload, good damage, good firing rate, good damage, good reload rate, good firing rate, and on down the line. I just kind of feel like there isn't really anything I need to change here, which is kind of interesting. Mobility type. The only reason I would go there is, yeah, I agree, adding the additional booster consumption. But on the other hand, you've got Neutron Jammer Canceller. So I wouldn't be too worried about that at this point. The agility, yeah, is definitely something. Where is it right there? I might even do this enemy auto lock-on thing. That looks a bit interesting.
Well, can I say something in the defense of that jump booster?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you stated earlier that when you're boosting, even though you have the NJC active, Neutron Jammer Canceller, anyway, when you have that active and you jump upwards, I'll say right there, dash jumping, you'll see that the boost bar is going down, but when you do it that way as well, it doesn't affect that. It only affects vertical. It doesn't affect diagonal or horizontal. So literally, you stay up in the air a whole lot longer, and the only time you come down is to try and hit that double jump again.
That's true. Yeah, that's true. But that would also be true of this level 8 enemy lock-on distance decrease, because the second thing there says no additional booster consumption when double jump. So in other words, you jump the first time, it'll consume boost. You jump a second time, it consumes nothing. Except, you know, unless you're moving horizontally. And I was actually just about to get to this. The auto enemy auto lock-on distance would actually be a perk. It wouldn't necessarily be a selling point, so, you know, it's just kind of, you can't touch me, and I've got, you know, I don't have to worry about jumping as much as I used to. So, for me, this would be an acceptable substitute for this one down here. They behave more or less the same, except this one, like, it doesn't consume boost vertically, diagonally, it doesn't consume boost that way. So, yeah, I absolutely agree with that, but I haven't really had any need to worry about boosting, just because I tend to maintain my distance naturally as it is. So boost durations and boosting speeds and agility, I'm not in the Strike Freedom specifically. Thank God it's a scissors, because it's very well balanced in that regard. And like I said, I treat this as the scissors version of the Wing Zero Custom. I start out at long range, and then if necessary, yes, I will close. And I actually can operate it. This is a unit that can operate at close range. It's really good at that. That being said, if I'm going to keep my distance, I want to make my shots hurt more than I do the spamming or something along those lines. Because, like, it spams. It's already there. I don't see any need to modify what's already there. And so what I was going to say is, I might even go for a balance type. Let's see, what does this do? I don't remember. Attack power, defense, dash, speed, move, speed. Okay, that doesn't do anything for me. I might do something like, I might do the HP up, this out of force of habit, because I'm not very good with the dumbfire, I might do that. And, well, I could do the attack up, or I can do this no additional booster jump thing, which actually sounds pretty nice, because in my opinion, you don't want to double jump and stay up in the air for very long, so that second boost jump is actually something I want to avoid doing. Nullify shield in certain distance, that sounds pretty good. That's actually a defensive bonus right there, so that's pretty good. No, I'm sorry, that's an assault, or that's an attack type. Because you usually see it right there. Same thing, actually it's something different. Yeah, okay, what do I know? Okay. Combine. Moving on, combine, it's pretty good. Again, oh, okay, I won't say that. Yeah, combine. And grow unit, I don't have to worry about that. Why am I going through these? I'm not quite sure why. Obviously, the reload up definitely gives the strike freedom its main punch. Without the reload up. Without the reload up, is the strike freedom still a competent unit? Yes, absolutely. The reload up... Also, Reload Up actually doesn't break Strike Freedom. It doesn't turn it into an OP unit. Correct me if I'm wrong, cool kid. Strike Freedom, in general, is not considered OP, is it? It's not considered broken.
In terms of SDGO, it's not OP. It's like you were saying, and I most definitely agree. It's really well balanced now that I think about it, but you've got a good amount of shots, the reload plus the reload up is excellent, and the more you get around, the more you get used to the unit, see what it does, and it all really depends on your playstyle. It's extremely good and no matter what you do, but like I was just saying, it all depends on your playstyle. Whether it be supportive or complete tank and assault.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's not OP, but it's not meh. Like many, many other units that have come out over the years, either before or after Strike Freedom Gundam, this is not a unit where it's not OP, but on the other hand, it's not boring. This is probably one of the most well-balanced and one of the most competent units out there. And that's not even including the ultimate boosting capability of a Neutron Jammer Canceller EX with radar and search distance. I don't care about search distance, you're going to be on top of them in a split second anyways. But the reload up doesn't break the unit. It doesn't make it too powerful. It's a very well-balanced unit. Stickers. So, we've got one in the right, and we've got one on the left, and I totally can't remember where it places the third one. It's in the... Okay, yeah, right there.
So, which, yeah. I would say that's a generic sticker placement. It would have been better if it went onto one of the wings or one of the dragoons.
You wouldn't want to put it on the dragoons, because that would be too small, and B, if you're throwing it out, if you throw a dragoon...
Nobody would see it.
Yeah, you wouldn't see it. So, yeah, I mean, where it is, it's fine where it is. And then putting it on the shield emitters wouldn't be a good idea either. Why can't I move this?
Yeah.
Moving on.
I've hated when that happens. But, yeah, I understand it.
Yeah, so, like that. Yeah, okay, whatever. So, whatever.
Hey, it could be like the 00 gun, or could be like the 00 series, and place the sticker on the crotch.
Oh, touche. Okay, so we're back to the red. Let's see, was that? That goes
well,
there.
If I saw your last video, yeah, there it is right there. You have the paint eraser.
I have a paint eraser, yes, sir. What of it?
Well. Well, what I was going to say is, why not show it off in its normal coloring, or place a random picture somewhere of its normal coloring?
Yeah, normal looks like a Gundam. Whoopsie shit.
Yeah.
That does bring up a good point, though. You know what? That's actually a good thing that you brought that up. I would like to point out the Strike Freedom Gundam does have a color that is forced down your throat, and that is the gold. All the gold on here. You cannot change it. It doesn't have a gray colored inner frame just because of canon. It doesn't have a gray or a dark gray or a military gray, green grayish colored inner frame. It actually has a gold colored frame. Like I said, that's a continuity thing. I won't bring it up here. But yeah. So that is something that you have to contend with, and you can see all the gold bits. It's even in the arch of the feet right there. It's in the hands. The cannon, whatever, but it's in the shoulder joints. It's everywhere. It's all over the place. It's the inner framework of the unit that has turned it gold. So that very much is something you have to contend with, which is why, as you just saw a moment ago, I didn't go with the standard AVA unit four-color scheme. Now it is a prototype unit. I actually hadn't come up with my prototype scheming when I got this, so I don't know how I would... Let's see. Maybe... this? I don't know. And then keep the white where it is, probably. No, let's see. This goes here, and then... I'll just put this here as a stand-in. Eh, that's kind of okay. Let's see, where'd the black go? Just keep that there, move out. Okay, whatever. Yeah. And as always, Strike Freedom, again, one of those units that paints up really well. Doesn't really matter what you use it on. So, I actually like this one. So, bit angelic, bit like Jesus himself. Moving on. So for me, it's so well balanced that I don't really see any need to change anything. At that point, really you just say, well, you change it because you can. Do an increased attack, increased HP, increased defense. Maybe I should do that in the defense tree. I mean, in my opinion, it doesn't really need anything. It has no flaws with it, is what I'm saying. Strike Freedom is just kind of good where it is.
Just make sure.
Would you say that?
I actually would, and just like I was about to say, make sure you count off the number of Dragoon shots you do, I guess we've got to repeat over and over again, which is 8.
Well, we don't have to repeat it over and over, but I see what you're saying. Yeah, you do definitely have to count how many shots you make with your Dragoons. It's still 6 times that you have to press the trigger in order to fire the things off, but on the other hand, you don't have to... But as soon as you do get that 6th shot off, you do have to worry about knocking them over right away. That is probably the only kind of big flaw with the Strike from Gundam. And really, of all the things that could happen, it's annoying, but it's not so bad that I would discourage you from getting one. I'll put it that way. This is definitely a unit worth getting. Any final thoughts, cool kid? You think we've missed anything here?
Final thoughts. Besides me being a seed fanboy, SDGO wise, get the unit. It's beautifully crafted, and it's balanced all around. If you can learn what does what, and you know the perfect timing on it, you can completely wreck face with it.
And you would say that of units in SDGO or mobile suits that are represented in SDGO, where there's, you know, the hero or whoever starts out with one mobile suit and then they upgrade to another unit later on, or another mobile suit later on, would you say that the Strike Freedom is a worthy successor in SDGO weapons and mobility and all that stuff, is a worthy successor of the original Freedom Gundam? Can you look at one unit and say, oh yeah, it's related to this? Would you say that?
Weapon-wise, yes. Mobile suit-wise, yes. It's
so
worthy of...
Answer would be yes, right?
It's worthy of both titles that it came from, both Strike and Freedom.
Okay.
Or, yeah, it's...
So you're saying it may also have, like, even though it doesn't have homing weapons and it doesn't have ballistic weapons, you're saying that it's still you're saying that you see echoes of the Strike Gundam in this as well, not just visually.
Okay. I do see a lot of it, and that would actually be its versatility with its weapons.
Good point. All right, Koolkid101495, I believe we are now even for the shit that I pulled on you last stream. Thank you very much for joining me on this occasion.
You're very welcome. I would say check out my channel, but I haven't posted anything for a while. And in that regards, I am Koolkid101495.
No self-promotion. Shut your face. This is Ava Unit 4A saying thanks for tuning in.
Hey, guys, I don't mean to burst your bubble, but seed sucks.